Good morning. Thank you, and welcome to the Statewide Multi-Unit Housing Forum. Today's topic is marijuana in leased or multi-unit residential housing. My name is Erica Berg, and I work with Denver Public Health, where I provide statewide technical assistance for housing providers wishing to go smoke-free. As you may know, marijuana use in multi-unit housing has complicated implementation and enforcement of multi-unit housing policies. Today, we will examine some significant aspects of marijuana use in the housing setting. Our presenter today, Annie Murphy, is licensed to practice law in Colorado, Utah, and Wisconsin, and has been practicing real estate law with Dufford, Waldeck, Milburn, and Crone, LLP, for over 10 years. Her knowledge of real property law allows her to provide legal counsel in all aspects of real estate litigation, as well as residential and commercial transactions. Annie's understanding of the legal complexities of landlord-tenant issues, fair housing, and federally subsidized and tax credit properties is reflected in her contributions to the legal field in the form of frequent seminars, publications, and involvement in Colorado real estate cases. Annie earned her Juris Doctor from University of Utah College of Law in 2003. You can learn more about her and Dufford, Waldeck, Mildern, and Crone, LLP, at www.dwmk.com. Please feel free to type in questions or ask them during the presentation, and also please take a moment, if you have not already, to mute your phones. Thank you, and I now present to you Annie Murphy.
Good morning. Thanks, Erica. I just wanted to, I'm glad you told everyone to mute their phones. Regarding questions, you can type in your questions at any time, and how we will deal with your questions is that at the end of certain sections, Erica will read your questions to me, and then I will answer them. We'll also, if there is time, we can hold a Q&A session at the end, and if you have a question, you can simply either unmute yourself or there's an icon at the top left-hand corner of your screen that says raise hand, and I don't know if that will work either, or it might be easier to just type your questions. So I will be discussing first just what the current laws are regarding marijuana and its legality in Colorado, because when you are considering what kind of policy to implement at your property regarding marijuana, you really need to have a thorough understanding of the law first. So marijuana, there are two constitutional amendments regarding marijuana, and the first is medicinal marijuana, the legalization of medicinal marijuana, and the second, the more recent, is the legalization of recreational marijuana. So I'll be discussing both. I'm going to start with a discussion of what the recreational marijuana law is, and then next talk about the medicinal marijuana law, which was Amendment 20, and recreational marijuana was Amendment 64. So recreational use, Colorado legalized the recreational use and possession in 2012. It's not the only state to allow recreational use. The state of Washington legalized marijuana the same year that Colorado did. And then in 2015, Alaska joined, Oregon, and also Washington, D.C. But a major issue that you need to remember is that although the use is legal in the state, possession and sale of marijuana remains illegal under federal law. So, and we'll discuss that a little bit later, but it's important to understand that we always will have this conflict of law between state and federal, unless the federal government changes its law regarding the use of marijuana. So what does Colorado law allow? Two major categories. First is the personal use of marijuana, and that's the part of the law that you are going to be most concerned with as property managers and owners of real property. It also, the amendment also concerns the lawful operation of marijuana-related facilities, so like retail shops, manufacturing, processing plants, things like that. And it also addresses how municipalities can develop further regulations regarding marijuana. So we are just going to be focusing on the personal use of marijuana. And what does personal use mean? First of all, a person needs to be 21 years of age or older to enjoy the rights that this law affords. And they are able to, and these words, I'm actually quoting the Constitution right here in this slide, and it's important to know what these verbs are. Persons 21 years of age or older may possess, use, display, purchase, and transport 1 ounce or less of marijuana, as well as marijuana accessories. They are also allowed to possess, grow, process, or transport no more than 6 marijuana plants, and the rule with that is 3 or fewer can be mature plants, which means flowering plants, and 3, I guess, have to be dormant if they have 6. And then possession of the marijuana produced by the plants on the premises where the plants were grown, that's legal as well, provided that the growing takes place in an enclosed, locked space. Okay, so you can't just do it openly in a backyard. And the growing is not to be conducted openly or publicly, and people cannot make it available for sale. So that's important to know regarding the growing of marijuana plants. It is also legal to transfer 1 ounce or less of marijuana to another person. Again, they cannot sell it, but they can transfer it, give it to someone else, as long as that person is 21 years of age or older. And it's legal to consume marijuana, and consume means, you know, in all different manners, such as smoking or eating, vaporizing, using hash oil, things like that. And then there's an exception in the consumption part of the law. The law says a person cannot consume marijuana openly and publicly, and a person cannot consume marijuana in a manner that endangers others. What those two phrases exactly mean, we don't know yet, because the legislature did not define those terms in the law, and also this law is too new to have any case law that has interpreted both of those provisions. And lastly, personal use means that someone can assist another person who's 21 years of age or older in conducting any of the above activities. So, for example, someone could grow a plant for another person. Okay, so next slide. May a housing provider prohibit the use of recreational marijuana in residential homes and units? Yes, absolutely, and that is specifically provided for in the Constitution. The Constitution says that a person who owns or controls a property, so that's, you know, an owner of the property, a property manager, a landlord, that person may prohibit or otherwise regulate the possession, consumption, use, display, transfer, distribution, sale, transportation, or growing of marijuana on that property. And I highlighted those words because when I draft lease provisions, I include those specific words in my rules, since it states in the Constitution that those are the things that you can regulate. And on the bottom right-hand corner, that's the section of the Constitution that rule comes from. So are there any questions just about what the law of recreational marijuana says or means? And if not, then I'll just move it on to medical marijuana. Okay, it sounds like there's no questions. So medical marijuana, again, that was Amendment 20, and basically that law allows for a person who has a debilitating medical condition, and that's a defined term, may engage in the medical use of marijuana with no more marijuana than is medically necessary to address a debilitating medical condition, but that person may not use marijuana in a way that endangers the health or well-being of any person. So that's very similar to the limitations on the use of recreational marijuana. And a person may not use marijuana in plain view of or in a place open to the general public. Again, that's very similar to the rule in recreational marijuana. One thing that you should know is that medical marijuana is now legal in 23 states and the District of Columbia. So basically half the United States allows the use of medical marijuana. So there is more law that has interpreted the use of medical marijuana than recreational marijuana, particularly in the employment context. And we use those cases to help us interpret what Colorado law or what Colorado judges may do in those in certain circumstances. So what's a debilitating medical condition? That's the next slide. There's kind of a long definition, but in short, for sure, if someone has cancer, HIV, or glaucoma, basically if someone just has a physician's note or something that says that they have one of those three medical conditions, that's considered a debilitating medical condition. Or if someone has a chronic condition, so that's something that's a condition that's ongoing, with a physician's opinion that their condition may be reasonably alleviated with the use of marijuana. So that's almost like a physician prescription for medical marijuana. There is no age minimum, so that's different than the law for recreational marijuana where you have to be 21. If you are eligible under the law to use medical marijuana, there is no age minimum. So someone who is 18 or 19 can get a prescription for medical marijuana. A parent can get a prescription for medical marijuana for their child. And another important difference between medical marijuana and recreational marijuana is that if you have a medical marijuana license, you are able to possess up to 2 ounces of marijuana rather than just the 1 ounce. So those are the major differences between the two rules. The next slide, may a housing provider prohibit the use of medical marijuana? Yes, although in the medical marijuana law, there's not an express, so there's not a written rule in there that specifically says a property owner may prohibit, like there was in the recreational marijuana law. Although it does say that an employer can prohibit the use of it. But we know that a housing provider may prohibit the use of marijuana for many other reasons. Most importantly, because the medical marijuana amendment, it does say that it's not a grant to medical marijuana users, so it doesn't give medical marijuana users the right to use that drug in any place or in any manner. And there's, since that law is much older than the recreational marijuana law, we do have several cases that have interpreted the medical marijuana law, and those again are in the employment context, but we can interpret those cases into how a judge might interpret that law as it would apply to a housing provider. and some of, and I included some case notes here on this slide. One is that the Medical Marijuana Amendment does not give medical marijuana users the unfettered right to violate employers' policies and practices regarding the use of controlled substances. And we believe that that same rule would apply to a housing provider, that this, that the right of someone to use medical marijuana does not give them the right to violate a housing provider's policy regarding the use of controlled substances. And same with this next point. This was from a case. The judge said that an employer's zero-tolerance drug policy prohibiting just illegal drugs, the policy didn't say, oh no. I wonder if anyone can hear you. Hello?
So unfortunately, if
can you hear me?
If people could please make sure that their phones are muted.
I thought
and,
I was cut off. Okay.
Remember, if you place us on hold and your agency has music playing on the line, it will come through and drown out the conference. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So when an employer had, in this case, an employer had a zero-tolerance drug policy, again, the policy prohibited all illegal drugs. It didn't mention marijuana specifically. And the court held that that applied to the employees, to an employee's use of medical marijuana, because marijuana remains an illegal substance under federal law. And again, we believe that that same rule would apply to a housing provider. So for instance, if you already have in your lease a policy that completely prohibits illegal drugs, marijuana would remain, the use of marijuana, including medical marijuana, your zero tolerance policy would apply to that use because it remains an illegal substance under federal law. So next, how can you prohibit marijuana? Let's say you don't have a provision in your lease currently. It has to be dealt with in your lease. Like I just said, your lease may already prohibit certain types of criminal activity. So you should be very familiar with your lease as it's currently written and review what the lease says regarding criminal activity. If it does prohibit all criminal activity, that probably includes marijuana, because marijuana remains criminal activity under federal law. I would recommend, if you want a total prohibition on marijuana, to specifically include that in your lease, because let's face it, a tenant will not consider that to be illegal activity if since most tenants know that it's now legal in Colorado. So you can prohibit renters from growing and using marijuana by including the rule as a clause in your lease, or if you provide federally subsidized housing and you have the standard HUD lease that you can't really change, you can include that as a clause in your house rules. If this issue comes up for you after a lease has already been signed without a clause, then of course you would have to rely on your anti-drug or your crime policy that hopefully was included or is included in your former lease or the lease that's currently being used. And there's other ways while someone's currently in a lease, you'll have to review your own lease to see how you can change your lease. Every lease is different as to how you can change it. If you manage federally subsidized property, there's a specific way that you can change your house rules with certain notice and things like that. What if you have a no smoking provision? Does that include marijuana? Well, I don't know, because I don't know what your no smoking provision looks like, but if your smoking policy, if the definition of smoking is not limited to tobacco, then yes, your policy would include marijuana smoke. But you need to be careful with your definition of smoking. What does smoking mean? Does smoking mean just smoking a cigarette? Does smoking include vaping? I don't know. So you have to look at your policy. And if you want that to include marijuana smoke, you need to make sure that rule is broad enough to include all types of smoke or specifically include the term marijuana in there. And it's also important to know that a no smoking provision, if you're relying on only that to control your marijuana use by tenants, well, that's not going to prohibit them from growing or using marijuana in other ways. So, and growing is a big concern for many property managers and property owners. So realize that if you have a no smoking provision and it does include marijuana or is broad enough to not limit it to tobacco, well, you still have an issue with all of the other things, all the other rights that a tenant now has under the state law regarding marijuana, including growing up to 6 plants indoors. Next slide. The Colorado Clean Air Act was amended after the recreational marijuana law was enacted, and they've included, the legislature has included marijuana in the definition of smoking. And the Colorado Clean Air Act specifically provides that housing providers may prohibit marijuana smoke on and in the properties they own or control. So you have two sources under the law, Amendment 64 and the Colorado Clean Air Act, that both give you express authority to prohibit marijuana smoke. So if a tenant raises the issue with you of, well, it's my constitutional right to use marijuana and smoke marijuana in my own unit, you can point to both of those laws. The Constitution itself, that gives you as an owner or manager of the property the right to prohibit marijuana smoke, and the Colorado Clean Air Act, which again gives you the express right to control what happens inside your property. Okay, and then what about federal law? So I told you that there was a conflict. Federal law still prohibits the use of marijuana, even medical marijuana. And how do we deal with that? How do we deal with the conflict? Well, the laws so far that have discussed this conflict in Colorado, or the courts, I should say, they've said, well, this is called federal preemption. So if there's a state law and a federal law that are in conflict, that say two different things, federal law will trump state law, and that's called federal preemption. Basically, the court is saying that's not an issue because there's no part of the Colorado law that must give way in order for federal authorities to enforce the Controlled Substances Act. And the Controlled Substances Act is the act that prohibits the use of drugs, including marijuana. So what that means is if the DEA, that's the the Federal Drug Enforcement Authority, if they wanted to, they could still come to Colorado and prosecute someone federally for the use, possession, growing, manufacturing of marijuana, okay? There's nothing in the state constitution that says, no federal government, you can't come in here and enforce your own law. And because we don't have that, because our state would still allow the federal government to come in and prosecute someone for violating the Controlled Substances Act, that's why they're saying that this law is okay. So what's important for you to know as a property owner is that could happen. I mean, the DEA is not really going after personal use, but it could happen, and that's definitely something to be aware of, that nothing in our state law protects you from being prosecuted from the federal government if something's going on in your property. Okay, so to summarize the rules, a tenant does have a right under Colorado law to use, grow, smoke marijuana inside their unit unless it's prohibited by you as a property owner or a landlord. And they need to know about that where in their lease. They need to know about the prohibition in their lease or a lease attachment if it's a part of the lease, like the house rules. And what are your rights as a property owner? You have the right, like I said, to prohibit the use and cultivation. Cultivation is the growth of marijuana on and in your properties, even though they're private units. You can control what happens inside. If you are the manager of public housing, HUD has provided specific guidance regarding medical marijuana. And if you don't have that official guidance, you can email me and I will send you a copy of the most recent guidance about that. But that guidance specifically says that marijuana is not a reasonable accommodation, and I'll go into that a little bit later about why it's not. Okay, so what are the options for you as a property owner? What can you do? Now that you know what the rules are, you can implement a total prohibition policy. You can allow the use only as a reasonable accommodation. You can allow just certain types of use or possession. For instance, you could outlaw just the growing and smoking, but allow the use of edibles. Or you could do total allowance. Now, you don't have all of those options if you are managing federally subsidized properties. So depending on what your funding source is, for instance, HUD has specific requirements regarding marijuana for public housing. You also don't have that option if you manage some other types of properties like rural development properties. The USDA has specific guidance regarding illegal drug use occurring on the properties. And again, illegal drug use includes marijuana because it's illegal under federal law. So you need to make sure not only that you're following the law in Colorado, but also that you are following the regulations of whoever your funding source is. And when you're deciding whether to prohibit marijuana use on your property, some considerations that I want to discuss, and hopefully you guys can chime in on some concerns that you may have or that you think of that I don't have listed here. But some considerations, number one, the impact of neighbors or other tenants. We all know that marijuana smells. and secondhand smoke issue and the health issue aside, there's an obnoxious odor that comes along with the use of marijuana and also the growth of marijuana plants. They have a very pungent odor as well. So this will... the allowance of smoking or using marijuana without any prohibitions at all would impact neighbors and other tenants. Erica, did you want to speak at all to the secondhand smoke issue?
Yeah, I mean, one thing that I would just like to add to that is that we know very specifically that secondhand tobacco smoke is extremely dangerous. And at this time, what research is showing us is that there is no reason to believe that marijuana smoke is any more safe because it does contain a lot of the same poisons in it and a lot of the same carcinogens.
Okay, thanks. Another consideration is just the marketability of your property. And honestly, that can go either way, right? You could live in a very marijuana-friendly part of town, or and maybe your policy that, you know, you can do whatever you want here regarding marijuana would be a selling point. But it definitely could also go the other way. If you allow smoking on your property, including marijuana smoke, that could be a huge deterrent. I mean, you can probably imagine showing a prospective tenant a new unit, walking them down the hallway and having them smell marijuana smoke. And maybe they decide not to rent that unit because they can already smell the marijuana smoke or the lingering marijuana smoke from the last tenants. So it can definitely affect the marketability of your property. And the trend is to go non-smoking. We all know that HUD just last year, or they're working right now on the new rule to prohibit all smoking in all federally subsidized housing. So again, the trend is to go non-smoking. And then safety. There's a safety consideration, and one safety concern is a fire risk from not only just grow lights, but also if you are allowing, or if you have tenants who are growing marijuana plants in their property. Well, it requires to grow marijuana plants, it requires a very strong grow light, and some tenants will rewire themselves, their property, to allow for the use of these grow lights, and that's a fire hazard. And actually, another safety hazard property concern is mold. These growing marijuana plants also requires, my understanding is that it requires some humidity, and there have been, I've heard of reports of mold when tenants are growing marijuana. And also, kind of a new thing is this really strong hash oil, butane hash oil. That's a very potent form of marijuana. It's like, I forget what it is, like 5 to 9 times stronger, or it's like 80 to 90% THC. So it's a very concentrated form of marijuana. And there is an explosion risk with tenants trying to make their own hash oil, which again, that would be legal, right, under Colorado law, but not if you prohibit it in your property. You also should consider your property insurance. Look at your property insurance policy. If there was a fire or if there was certain damage, that resulted from a tenant's use of marijuana, would that be covered under your insurance policy? Would that be covered under the tenant's rental insurance policy? A lot of times, an insurance policy will exclude, they love to exclude everything, right? But there'll be an exclusion for criminal activity. So, and marijuana, again, it would be considered criminal activity under that broad definition of criminal activity because it's illegal under federal law. So that is another concern. And I also touched on compliance with funding source regulations. You want to make sure that you're in compliance with that. I presented at a USDA Rural Development Conference some years ago and was discussing marijuana. And one of the directors from USDA stood up and said, "We will pull your loan if you allow, if we find out that a property owner is allowing the use and possession of marijuana on the property." Like, she stood up and said that. So there are some very serious consequences from funding sources if you were to allow that use on your property. Are there any other comments about considerations on what policy you should implement in your property from people who are listening? Okay, well, I don't hear any, so I'll move on. And I guess I already talked about the next slide. Will your insurance policy or the tenant's insurance policy cover damages caused by marijuana? Maybe, but probably not. So the next topic I'm going to go into is special circumstances for public housing providers. Like I said, there's some official guidance, and if you're interested in the official notice and guidance, let me know and I'll just send you a copy of that. But some important points to know. First of all, for new admissions, so for a prospective tenant, based on federal law, new admission of current marijuana users, including medical marijuana users, are prohibited into public housing and housing choice voucher programs. So if a tenant comes in to is applying and they tell you that they are using marijuana, you need to deny them admission. If they don't tell you, that's a different story. But if they are upfront with you, you don't even ask them any questions, and they're like, "Hey, I use medical marijuana. Here's my card." You, under the law, you're supposed to deny them admission. If they are a current resident, that's a completely different story. So you are allowed to establish occupancy standards and lease provisions, like we discussed, that will allow you to terminate assistance and tenancy for the use of a controlled substances. And you also have the discretion, but not the duty, to determine on a case-by-case basis the appropriateness of program termination of existing residents for the use of medical marijuana. And so the policy behind this is, HUD does not want people to be homeless because of certain what they would consider maybe a minor violation. And by minor violation, that could be now, since, marijuana is legal, just a one-time, personal use violation. And that's actually now consistent also with our state law, too. They don't want you to throw someone out. And so that's why they say that you have the discretion to determine on a case-by-case basis whether you should terminate someone's tenancy based on their use of medical marijuana or marijuana. One thing that you need to understand, though, is it's so important to treat all tenant violations consistently throughout the board, because if you treat one tenant differently from another for the same lease violation, and let's say that lease violation is the use of marijuana, and you decide to terminate one household but not another household, well, then you run into a potential fair housing claim for treating someone differently. So it's important to make sure you have a good internal policy of what you're going to do with these type of violations, and then enforce that consistently throughout the board. Next slide. Just must a public housing authority deny admission to a current user of marijuana? Yes. Okay. I'm going to move on to lease violations and termination of the lease. Enforcement of your policy is more challenging than drafting the policy itself. When you have a marijuana-related lease violation, first you have to determine what term of your lease has been violated. You have to prepare the notice. What did they violate? Did they violate a no-smoking provision? Did they violate a criminal activity provision of the lease? Do you have a clause in your lease regarding marijuana? You need to determine what's been violated. And once you do that, you can decide, again, follow your internal policy, whether to exercise your right to declare a default or a breach of the lease. So if you decide to do that, just be aware, I have this note here, that if if you don't declare a default or a breach of lease and the tenant or other tenants continue to use marijuana, they know that you know about it, and then let's say a couple years down the road, you can't stand this tenant or their family or their guests, and they're totally insubordinate, are causing all sorts of trouble, and then you decide, well, they're violating the lease. They're using marijuana. I'm going to evict them now based on that. Well, what the tenant can do is use your inaction. So that's called waiver under the law as a defense or an argument that you waived your right to declare a default or a breach in the lease based on that particular lease violation because you let it go for so long. So that's an important thing to consider. If you decide that, okay, a breach of this part of the lease, a breach of our no using marijuana or no smoking marijuana provision is something that we're going to enforce, then you should enforce it consistently. Okay, so some considerations, considering the well-being of other tenants on the property, is the activity, and this is why this goes along with HUD's direction that things that these type of violations should be determined on a case-by-case basis. So is this activity impacting the use and enjoyment of the premises by the other tenants? If it's a smoking concern, then I would argue, yeah, that is impacting the use and enjoyment of the premises by the other tenants. If it's a growth thing, if the tenants are growing marijuana, well, yeah, then that's also a concern for you because it's impacting the value of your property, the condition of your property, and maybe the smell is obnoxious. And are the tenants using it and then, you know, going nuts or something and disrupting everybody? Well, then that's also impacting the use and enjoyment. If not, if you just heard from someone else that they're eating brownies or something and they're not causing any trouble, well, that's maybe a different story. And the other consideration is, are you comfortable with a situation occurring on your property that your tenant is in violation of federal law? Are you okay with knowing that's going on your property and letting that occur? Next slide, internal policy. So again, make sure you have that all of your property managers are on board with what your internal policy is regarding enforcing this type of a lease violation. It'd be best if it's in writing. If it's not in writing, at least make sure that everyone is trained, all of your managers are trained on what to do. For example, let's say for smoking violations, you have like a three-strike rule. You know, first time you do an oral warning, second time you do a demand for compliance, third strike, you do a notice to quit, for example. Maybe that's your internal policy. If that's what it is, make sure that everybody knows it so that it can be applied consistently. You should have an internal policy about how to respond to these type of lease violations, as well as how to respond to a request for a reasonable accommodation to smoke medical marijuana so that everyone can apply these policies consistently. For notice requirements, so since marijuana is now legal in Colorado, its use is no longer considered a substantial violation under Colorado law. In the past, before recreational marijuana was legal, if we had a marijuana use situation, even if it was just a personal use, you had the right to evict without giving them a chance to comply. You could just do a notice to quit, a three-day notice to quit for a substantial violation under the law because it was a drug crime. Now, you can't do that anymore. You have to give them a chance to comply. So for a first offense, the most you can do is serve them with a demand for compliance or possession, saying that they have 3 days to comply with the lease. Basically, don't you can't be caught smoking marijuana in these next 3 days. And then if they do it again, then you can serve them with a notice to quit for a repeated violation, as long as it's for they violated the same term of the lease. Any questions on enforcement or comments? Okay, then we're going to go on to whether medical marijuana is a reasonable accommodation. And this is where it gets, I think, a little bit more interesting and expensive for you guys when there's reasonable accommodation requests or threats of fair housing complaints. So the applicable laws related to reasonable accommodation are the Federal Fair Housing Act, Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act, which would apply to federally funded properties, and the ADA. They all prohibit discrimination against persons with disabilities in public housing and other federally assisted housing. And then also the Colorado Fair Housing Act as well. Section 504 and the ADA say that medical marijuana users, or the regulations say that medical marijuana users are not considered just by virtue of them being a medical marijuana user or them showing you their medical marijuana card. They're not considered disabled or handicapped. So if someone says, yeah, I'm disabled, look, here's my medical marijuana card, that's not evidence that they're disabled under the Fair Housing Act or the ADA. The regulations concerning the Fair Housing Act say that allowing the use of medical marijuana is not a reasonable accommodation. But how does this work with the Colorado Fair Housing Act? On the next slide. Because both the Colorado and the Federal Fair Housing Act create a statutory right to reasonable accommodation upon proof of a disability and an appropriate request. And if you could be faced with, if you just deny, so if someone comes to you, says that they're disabled, either you know they're disabled or they show you proof that they're disabled, and they ask for, and you have a prohibition policy on the use of marijuana, and they ask you to use marijuana because it's going to help them with their disability, they show you a note from a doctor, yada, yada. And you just say no. No, we don't allow that. That's the Federal Fair Housing Act says it's not a reasonable accommodation. No. Could you still get in trouble? Yes, in Colorado you could, because it's legal in Colorado, and we have a Colorado Fair Housing Act. So a tenant could file a fair housing complaint in a Colorado state court and invoke this act, or they could file a complaint with DORA, with the Colorado Civil Rights Division, and allege a violation of this act. The way that you can, and I'm not saying that you have to allow it as a reasonable accommodation, what I want to emphasize is that you have to treat it as a request for reasonable accommodation and follow the appropriate steps to decide whether they're entitled to reasonable accommodation, and if so, what can you grant or what can you do? So if someone requests a reasonable accommodation, you can ask them for proof that they're disabled and that they need that specific accommodation. If they provide you those proofs, you can still say no, but you need to have a dialogue with them and figure out what you may be able to do to accommodate their disability. This is kind of a short step-by-step guideline. In determining whether the request is reasonable, one consideration that you can use is, well, it's not reasonable because it's a crime under federal law. That is completely okay to have that as one of your reasons of why granting that request would not be reasonable. Another reason that you can deny that request for being unreasonable would be the secondhand smoke issue. It would affect other tenants, and for that reason, it would be unreasonable. But again, the conversation can't just stop there. You can try to figure out how else you could maybe help that tenant in granting a reasonable accommodation. And by failing to do that, that's where you could get into trouble. So in determining whether the request is reasonable, again, is it reasonable on its face? If they're asking to use an illegal drug, probably not. Probably not reasonable on its face. And does it impose undue financial or administrative burdens or require a fundamental alteration in the nature of the program? And allowing the use of an illegal drug would require a fundamental alteration in the nature of your program, and it would, you would be in violation of probably some of your funding source regulations by doing that. Okay, I have more to say on that, but I'm gonna move on since we don't have much time left to my last topic of landlord liability. So there are some potential claims that a tenant could have against a landlord or a property owner, manager, related to smoke intrusion. And this is a list of some of the claims that they could have. So if you allow secondhand smoke of any kind, including marijuana smoke, a tenant could bring a claim for nuisance against you. And the elements of nuisance are a substantial and unreasonable interference with a tenant's use and enjoyment of their real property. So substantial and unreasonable interference, the reasonableness would be based on the character of the neighborhood, the expectations that a reasonable, normal person would have under the same circumstances. So there have been cases where tenants have prevailed under this claim for secondhand smoke because it was the secondhand smoke that was coming, that was infiltrating into their unit or into their home was really affecting them. It was invading them, and they were unable to use and enjoy their real property to its fullest. So that's one. Another one is the violation of the warranty of habitability. In Colorado has a warranty of habitability, and you are warranting, basically you are promising to a tenant that the premises that they're going to be renting is habitable. And part of that promise is saying that it's a safe place to live. And if a tenant's unit is being infiltrated with secondhand smoke, they have an argument that their health and safety is being impacted by this secondhand smoke. Arguably, they could also say that their safety is being impacted because, you know, the next door neighbor is making hash oil, and they're afraid that there's going to be an explosion. So that's another claim that they could have. And that law in Colorado is pretty new also, the warranty of habitability, so we don't have a lot of case law on that, interpreting that statute. Fair housing violation, they could claim a fair housing violation. Let's say someone has asthma or some respiratory issues and secondhand smoke is coming into their unit, and they complain to you and say, hey, I need a reasonable accommodation because this secondhand smoke in my unit is really causing me breathing problems. I have asthma. Asthma is a breathing, failure to breathe well. That's a disability, under the Fair Housing Act. And if you fail to grant that reasonable accommodation by doing something about it, then a tenant has a claim for a fair housing violation. Another claim would be trespass, and that would most likely be against you know, the actual tenant who's causing the smoke to come in, but that's it can be a physical trespass, like the smoke is actually coming into the tenant's unit. So people have used that as a claim. And then also you could be liable for breaches of your own contracts with your funding sources for allowing the use of that. So with that, does anyone have, we have a few minutes left, does anyone have any questions or comments just about this topic in general? Or Erica, do you have anything else to add?
No, I'm looking to see if there's any questions here, and I'm not seeing any, but I would encourage folks, if you do have a question, feel free to just ask, or you can type it in the box.
Quiet group today.
All right. Well, thank you very much, everybody, for your time today. And thank you, Annie, for your presentation. And this concludes our smoke-free housing forum for today. Thank you.
Thanks.